happened in February, I believe, and then the climate kind of changed the timing that it's happening. So people are not forgetting about it, but it's just happening at a time where it's so far past the event.
Yeah.
I just feel like this debriefing definitely should have happened sooner.
Uh-huh.
Especially while it's still fresh and people could probably get their thoughts out momentarily.
Yeah.
Just felt like the timing was
here's the process. We found out that Ben Shapiro, or that the Young Americans for Freedom, had arranged for Ben Shapiro to come here. We found this out in December, right? We began discussions right away about the impact that would have on the campus. We discussed it with students, with faculty, with our security folks, etc. Because we knew that it could be an inflammatory event, right? And certainly the title or the talk and all that's calculated to have that effect. So we spent a number of weeks sort of going back and forth about how the climate was developing around this event, getting right up close to it, and I was consistently getting reports on a daily basis, trying and monitoring things myself. Some people were writing to me directly, trying to monitor the impact, the potential impact on the safety and security of the student, given that there were a lot of things being said in social media, emails, things like that, that certainly would be cause or more cause for concern. So I reached a point, but it was close, you know, because really needed to have all that we could possibly get. In which I said, look, I said, I think, and I talked to the cabinet about this, I talked to Chancellor White about it, I talked to our police officers about it. I said, I think you know, we should try to reconfigure this event, both because I think less combative event for everyone involved, and also because I feel like it's in the sort of DNA of Cal State LA to have dialogue and discussion and the inclusion of different points of view in that sort of venue. So, I mean, a lot of you are all, you know what I propose. I propose to the Young Americans for Freedom that we reschedule this at a time when we could. I didn't actually, you know, disinvite. I said, let's reschedule this at a time where we can have dialogue and there will be different perspectives represented, et cetera. So that was the process that sort of led to that. As you may know, the YAF said no, and Mr. Shapiro said no. I'm coming anyway. That prompted us to think about how best to configure the event or how best to respond. It was clear to me and clear to everyone around me that he and others were coming. And I wanted to have an event then that acknowledged that, and could not conceive of, nor did I have any legal recourse to a standoff, right? That precluded Ben Shapiro and others from setting foot on the Cal State University campus. It seemed to us at the time, and Vice President Juan McKee was in the room we were all discussing it, that the best way to try to think about this was to try to contain the event to make sure that it wasn't sort of open and out there where lots of violence could break loose. This was the original reservation for the event. We kept that reservation. There were, you know, YAF people who had Mr. Shapiro arranged to come in through the back, and some others who had reservations come in through the back. He spoke to them. It was live streamed. I watched it, and then exited. And in the meantime, of course, there were some YAF associated folks. I really don't know what their exact association was, and members of the university community that were engaged outside the event. So that's the way it transpired from my perspective.
Are any other future events going to be allowed by this group, or what's going to happen if they decide to throw another event?
Well, you know, that's the question on my mind. It really is. I mean, what do we do next time? And I'm convinced that there will be a next time. I mean, very tragically and unfortunately, we're in a kind of climate nationally and locally in which this kind of provocation is occurring. So I think that, you know, it could occur here. Now, Ray had a really good idea when we talked yesterday, and I hope that he and the students are able to continue to move this forward. That is, should one of the things, let me backtrack a little, one of the things that I saw a necessity for was to look at the university's processes for enfranchising events and ask ASI and other student groups to look at their processes for enfranchising and funding things. And Ray's idea sort of bundled this all together and said, shouldn't we think about a kind of policy or process or set of criteria that the students get behind and say for future events, for us to, as a student body, because this was, you know, these were student groups, this was was our student government, right? For us as a student body to support an event, it's got to have these elements and sort of get that out there. So I think that process, to my mind, I don't know what the result would be, but I think that process would be a healthy process.
Yes. For me, I can't speak for everybody. For me, I don't care about the whole, I believe in freedom of speech. So
yeah.
I mean, that's fine by me. I think the biggest issue that I had personally is the fact that, not so much the speech, but just it's like the fact that the YAF is a members were making threats at students. And that, for me, that's an automatic security breach. That's something that is like should have been already, those are red flags, especially since the previous year, Oregon Community College had been attacked, and they had had, you know, there have been recent is like school shootings and stuff like that, and these people we're talking about, who are from like Marietta, Redlands, Riverside, that they want to come down and do the same thing is like to our campus. So, I mean, I don't see how that shouldn't have is like throwing up some red flags, stop the event, and I think that would have been within legal parameter to say, look, it's like these people are coming to make threats, and we can't have that. That's, you know, something that I'm pretty sure that the law could have worked within your favor for that. So I'm not understanding why the event still continued on, even with that, with those type of threats.
Right. There were threats coming from that side. There were some threats that were issued from people with another perspective on the event on this campus, and there was that all concerned. We attempted, or I asked that we try to run down every threat that we knew about. Is the case that such exchanges of threats have happened at other institutions around the country, around events like this, and continue to. You can see them in the comments below news articles and other things everywhere. We finally concluded, as I said, that we did not have a basis disallowing a speaker at Cal State LA, but that it was important to me that we try and hold an event that had less chance of being dangerously confrontational than it would have if it were free form.
In the back,
and
then
we'll
take
that. Why were the police instructed to protect the protesters and Ben Shapiro and Ben Shapiro's supporters and not the students of this campus?
Why were the police instructed?
Why were the police instructed to protect Ben Shapiro and his supporters and not the students of this campus? Or why weren't the police specifically instructed to protect the students that paid tuition, not the outside agitators and not people that came from Orange County and not Ben Shapiro and his supporters who don't pay tuition here? This is a public university, but we pay tuition.
Right.
So why were the police instructed to protect the students?
They were.
Then why didn't they?
Well, if there are cases in which they didn't, we're running them down. If there are cases that we missed, I need to know about them. Because Vice President Wadamiki and I and the rest of the cabinet were all in the room with the police chief when I said, the students are to be protected. They are to have the right to protest. We are not going to interfere with that right. So that was a deliberate directive from me. If there were lapses in the consistent attention
well,
to that
police,
directive, then I just need
the police almost ran over me with your car.
Right.
So,
right.
I don't think my safety was at the forefront
yes.
of what they were thinking about.
That I have, and I think that a lot of other people who couldn't make
during the event, I was, as you might imagine, monitoring it. I was in close touch with all of the folks that were in the situation. We were having regular interchanges about what was happening, and I was trying to give my best advice. Of course, they were doing the best they could as well. When everyone came to up to the office, it was my decision, and I take responsibility for it, not because of you folks at all, but because the building was open to anyone who wanted to come up and down the stairs, and there was no mitigation of that. I just decided that I needed to know more about the situation and what was going on, and to get as full a report as I could before I talked to you. So I did that. I had to be in a place where I could do that. I did that. I got briefed by everyone who wanted to brief me and we had Vice President Wadden McKee was here. The Dean of Students was with you, and they were certainly on the scene along with others. And once I did, I was happy to get in touch and to hear from you again.
Can I ask you something?
You are evading the question. Where were you physically when that was happening? That was a question, not,
Well, for only
us with everyone. You wanted to know where were you at that time. You are not on campus. Where were you? If you were, we didn't know, but where were you physically, geographically, at that moment?
Right. When I was talking.
No, during the event.
During the
event, after the event.
No, I was on campus.
And why did you avoid the students?
Which, what point are we now?
The students wanted to speak to you while they're in the hallways of the office.
Well, that's what I was just trying to address. Say that it was canceled.
What?
I can. Do you want me to speak to that?
Sure.
The Sex Toys R Us event was advertised in such a way that I felt, and it was my decision once again, I needed to talk with the students and see that we had some elements in place that would focus the event on the students at Cal State LA, that would not be thought to the students' disadvantage or to the organization's disadvantage to be the use of the Toys R Us logo, right? That's just it's a technicality, but you'd be surprised how often that happens. And also that we were careful about identifying those that were coming to the event as adult students, because we have two high schools on campus. All right. So I asked that the event not go forward as advertised until we had a chance to talk. And I talked face to face with the students who were organizing the event. We had a long meeting in my office. Then I went over to public affairs. I said, will you please work with the students here and see if we can get an event that satisfies the intention, but does not sort of tread into those territories that might make it, might create concerns that we don't need or want to create. So they did that. And the event then went off on the same day, at the same time that it was originally scheduled. I wasn't there. I don't know how the attendance was. Yeah.
exclusively because of their religion. That's exactly my point, though, is that you're talking about age for this event, but then we're talking about our lives for this event.
Right, right.
And that event was not canceled. And yet the sex show was. I mean, the sex event show, the sex event was. So that, to me, that doesn't equate. You're saying that your concern is us, but yet these threats are being made to people that are very in this room right now. And that event was still allowed to happen. And you just said that this event might a similar event might happen again. So is our security going to be put on the line again, just so that we don't create any negative publicity? Because honestly, what came out of it was negative publicity, right? So how are we going to move forward here, given this lack of security? Because we don't feel safe on this campus. We don't. You know, a couple of weeks before the Ben Shapiro thing, we had the thing that happened in San Bernardino.
Right.
How are we supposed to feel given that these people are going to be on our campus and they specifically targeted specific students here with threats of violence? Is our life not matter? Like, or what? Like, what's going on here? Because, like, do you just want our money from like our tuition and fees and just have these events so that like our funders can be like, you know, put on the line? I just don't get it, and I'm angry. Because now I don't feel safe coming to this school. I put my entire heart and soul and passion into this school. And now I don't feel comfortable coming here. Being in this own building, the same building that I go to every day, this is like my second home. And to have a racist, a bigot, a homophobe to come here to my home and express his views. I mean, how would you like it if somebody like that came to your house and started saying those things in your house and started disrespecting your house? That's a disrespect not only to us as students, but it's a disrespect to the space and the struggles that we have fought hard for to have this space.
And I agree.
You have only a few minutes left. He's got to take a plane, I'm sorry.
Okay. So I just wanted to know if anything happened to the individual that brought the gun on campus.
We've not been able to verify that report to this point. I've asked about it a number of times and asked for what the process was. We've not been able to verify that.
So you think we're making it up?
No, I've just told you I've not been able to verify. Processes that they use as professionals to act on it, and they have.
And in any way have you seen in the media law enforcement protecting us?
Oh, I understand. I understand that it's an imperfect situation in every way. But I have followed up on that particular report, have followed up personally, and cannot tell you anything further about observation that was made.
So my question is kind of informed by the Inside Higher Ed news source. And recently it came out with an article stating that one in 10 incoming freshmen are prepared to protest and to get involved in student activism. So if so along with the meeting in December with PSU, where you announced that there was initiatives to bring in more black college students or black high school students into college.
Right.
Like, how are we gonna really address these concerns and these feelings that like students don't feel safe here, especially as more students come in who are actually gonna be prepared to organize and mobilize for these same issues? How are we gonna move forward? Because if we continue to have the same discussion next year and the year after that, like, that's not what we want. We want for there to be work done and some, you know, some sense of progress, right?
Right, I agree.
Why do you plan to do that?
Well, I was speaking to it earlier. I think that, that the ideas that I've heard from some of you and others about putting in place, especially on the part of our student organization. Remember, I would have never invited Ben Shapiro to campus. Never. He was invited by students. He was funded by students. He was supported by students. I would have never invited anybody like Ben Shapiro to campus. So, what we need to put in.
A small minority of students. It's like.
I'm sorry, our regulations don't use that calculation. It was a legitimate student organization. So I'm not telling you that it's, you know, it's one that has any greater legitimacy than that. But we need to put in place, and you need to help with this, a set of benchmarks, priorities, criteria, etc., that deal with appearances like this, so that you as students, with the support, full support of the university, can say, no, we don't want this to happen. It wasn't my invitation.
Hold on, Dr. Abdullah.
But let's let the students finish and then.
Okay. ISIS, Dennis, Ray, and then
Ocean. Let me just tell you, I'm going to Sacramento to try to get money for us, so I'm sorry if I'm feeling a little bit pressed, but let's go on.
Okay, so it just surprises me, and I don't even have words to explain it, how you only had one approach to cancel the event. Like, did it ever occur to you that maybe these people, maybe they weren't going to comply with what you were going to say? Like, why didn't you think of other, like, plan B, you know, the other plans to stop the event instead of just saying, well, he's just going to be on the campus, we'll have campus security and police out there? Why didn't you have any other tactics?
Well, we did consider a broad range of things, and I am aware that whenever a decision is made, it could have been made differently, and the alternative decisions could have gone better, could have gone worse. So I understand what you're saying. We made the best decision we could at the time under the very complex circumstances that were part of.
You said the best decisions were made. Well, I guess my question then would be, how come the police personally escorted is like Ben Shapiro and some of his is like followers is like through different areas, is like just to get it in here into the theater? Because I noticed that the police were really is like out there really observe or making sure that, you know, students were being harassed or anything. They were too busy escorting is like this non-student, you know, the speaker and everything to come into, you know, through the back door and everything. Why is that? Why did this guest speaker get this special treatment, you know, this police escort, when they're supposed to be out there making sure that nobody's coming in, nobody's, you know, not coming in with any weapons or that they're not causing any fights? Because literally there was a few of them that were agitating, you know, were trying to make sure that something went off as far as, you know, touching students is like, you know, pushing students, shoving students, you know, which probably would have like caused like, you know, a mass fight or is like something, you know, could have gone wrong. And unfortunately, you know, the students are the ones that are viewed as we're uncivilized or by the media, or that we're taking this as a, you know, that we're not allowing freedom of speech. But yet we have these people that are coming in onto our campus and trying to cause fights and trying to cause a ruckus. So I don't understand that.
Well, we had 28 police officers here that day. Our contingent of police officers usually is 4. So we had 28 police officers here that day all over the CSU. We had them come in from other campuses, and they were stationed at any number of points. That's about as much of an answer as I can give to you, but we did have a large contingent to try to preclude the kinds of things that would worry you and would worry me.
See, but that still doesn't answer is like why the police escort, because when they were live streaming.
What were their instructions? Is that what you're trying to get at? Like, were they specifically spoke to and instructed to protect the student? Or did they just come on campus and this is what you're gonna do and you decide how you wanna do it? Like, I don't understand how that process
works. Well, as I said earlier, my instructions to the police were to protect the students.
You like personally told them that?
Yes, I told them in a cabinet meeting with all the vice presidents there and all the police officers.
Greg,
are
you gonna go first?
Do you have 5 more minutes?
Sorry. We're talking about solutions, how we can make sure something like that doesn't happen again, but also I'm questioning the decisions that come from the administration. I think administration thinks like administration, not like students. And I think you really should consider having committees of students in your decision-making process.
Yeah.
For a lot of processes on campus in general. So that is something that I would love to see, because I feel universities become this hierarchy of administration, faculty, staff, and students. We need to blur that up and make it more inclusive. And I think it's really important to welcome staff and faculty and students in every aspect of administration making decisions.
And that helps with transparency.
You're right. And it also creates transparency and unity on campus, and it will be more school spirit.
You're right.
David?
Yes. In the likely event that the Young Americans of Freedom have another guest such as Ben Shapiro, how do you intend the prevention of weapons coming onto campus, such as the gun that did come onto campus?
Well, I don't know what are you thinking. We should have like a screening process or something?
I'm not sure.
Do you have an idea? I'm not sure either. I think we use the expertise of our officers and their ability to spot and respond as they have been trained. I do know, you know, there are some universities, and I don't think we're reaching that point, that have put up metal detectors at various spots and things like that. I don't like the atmosphere here at Cal State LA. So I take your question seriously. I think that we could have to continue to ask it when we're faced with this, just exactly what kinds of skills, observation skills, and other skills are public safety people using.
So I wasn't gonna say anything because I technically work for you, although I work for the students, you know. So I hope that there won't be any backlash. I want to say that one of the things, several of us who were on faculty and staff were there.
Yeah.
And we had conversations before this event with your senior administration.
Right.
About even if you were going to let this happen, which I think it should have absolutely not happened, and I've talked to many legal scholars who were saying that this crossed the line, this was no longer free speech. But you made the call and decided, you know, you were gonna open up this campus to, if he were talking about Jewish folks in the way that he talks about black folks and brown folks, that never would have happened. He would have been seen as a neo-Nazi, as a Hitler, right? But because he's talking about black and brown folks, and especially black folks, it's not seen in the same way. And this is kind of this ongoing conversation about the specificity of anti-blackness.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, I think, what we see with Ben Shapiro. So even if you decided you're gonna let this neo-Nazi on campus, right? And I get he's Jewish, so that's ironic that I'm calling him a neo-Nazi, right? But that's basically what he is, the equivalent, a neo-KKK member, let's call him that, right?
Yeah.
One of the things that we talked about is your leadership. And so several of us witnessed students being brutalized by people who don't go here, grown folks, and I know you all are grown, but people old enough to be your parents and sometimes grandparents, pushing, shoving, in some cases knocking people to the ground, knocking our babies, our students, I'm sorry y'all not babies, but our students, we love y'all like that though, right?
Yeah.
Knocking our students to the ground, and staff and faculty were here, but the only two administrators that I saw at the event were your PR folks. And so one of the things we talked about in advance is if you're going to do that, just like the students' lives and safety were on the line, why didn't you put your own safety on the line? You could have shown such leadership, and I tried to pitch this to Jose. I was like, if President Covino were to come and stand on the steps of the USU, where several of us were standing, and made a declaration on a bullhorn, I don't agree with Ben Shapiro, but I'm saying freedom of speech is important, and so that's why I made this decision, and I'm sorry if you all are hurt by it, right? If you'd done that, that would have demonstrated leadership and care, genuine care for our students. But I think what I'm hearing is the students are hurt because you valued your safety enough to be in your 8th floor office in the administration building, but not their safety enough. The second thing I wanna say is I wanna applaud the students. I think they've waited for you to kind of come forward and have this conversation. But this was initiated by them. And my view is that, and I appreciate that you're bringing Michael Benitez, but all of the literature, and I've shared this as well, says that when there are these kind of racial tensions on campus, you can't run from them. You should be the one, you should have convened a debrief, not 3 months later, but like the next day or week, you know, and said, what are you feeling? Because what I'm hearing is students come into my office and feeling traumatized, right? Feeling brutalized physically, emotionally, and mentally. And we like you, and I'm speaking as a member of this university community that I love very much, right? We want you to step up and demonstrate leadership and genuine care for the students who go here. And the specificity, I know that you've given some resources based on BSU demands, but what are your own initiatives? How can you move forward out of your own volition, not just student demand? Because it's kind of like, I know you're married, right? And so I was married, I'm not anymore. But the negotiations you have with your spouse, where sometimes every marriage, your spouse will say, well, I need an apology. Well, when you issue the apology based on your spouse saying, I need an apology, nobody ever takes it as a real apology. But if you say, listen, you know, I understand you're hurt, and because I love you, I don't like to see you hurt, and I'm sorry, and that comes from you, and you make proactive steps to remedy it, that's when healing begins. And so I'm encouraging you to be that. I hope that you will be that.
Well, I hope that what I said at the beginning of this session was heard as an apology. I think you may have
heard
it, but
that's a black thing.
But I agree with you. But I agree with you. Okay, I'm sorry. I have to go try to get us some money from the governor and the legislature. Thank you very much for inviting me to this. Thank you for being candid and forthright. Let's see how we can work together to create something.